Hello, dear friends, my lovely audiences, my dear fellow Californians. Welcome back to the show. When I say back, we're talking about this is not the first show about election. This is another show on the election. The election may be over, and was over, matter of fact, may be over, but the concept remains. Today, in the aftermath of the election, I call it the aftershock of the election, I have my two dear friends, Honorable Bob Hoff, former Senator of California, recent candidate for the race, with me to share his thoughts, beautiful thoughts about the election. And then next to him is, I would not say the wife part first. I will take her social identity first. She, in my eye, is a political advocator. And she is a brief one, she is a big one, matter of fact. And by the way, she happens to be the wife of Bob Hoff. How about that? Right. That as a lead line, so you welcome to the show.
Thank you. Thank you, Jack.
All right. After the election, this is the third day, you want to give us a little bit about how you feel about the election, please?
Me first?
Yeah, you first. Lady first. We always say that.
Is it specifically about Congressional District number 39, Bob's race?
Mm-hmm.
Yes?
Yeah, you want to do it in an overall way. You want to specifically talk about one, okay. And you want to do overall way, okay.
Obviously, I know the 39 Congressional District the best, so I'll stay with that one. And maybe Bob can talk about election in general.
Sure.
It came as a shock that Senator Bob Hoff did not advance into top two, because a lot of our supporters didn't understand why. I think one of the biggest reason is this: Bob was the number one target by the Democrats, because they don't want Senator Bob Hoff to advance into top two. And they are trying to get their candidate into the top two, and they do not want their candidate to face Bob Hoff, because they know they cannot compare to Bob Hoff. In a one-on-one comparison fight, they have no chance. But because the current California election law is a top two system, so we call it a jungle primary, meaning out of the 17 mm-hmm. candidates in the mm-hmm. race run against each other, and the Democrat, the party, the Central Committee came out in a big way in the primary to pick basically the candidate that they want to face in general election. Mm-hmm. And they did not want to face Bob Hoff. So they put in a lot of money, and they started a negative campaign by mm-hmm. flyers, mailers, Facebook, social media, YouTube, cable. Instagram, cable, mm-hmm. all this negative campaigning against Senator Bob Hoff. And they're very smart, okay? They're smart mm-hmm. in this way, because there was a very, very, very big effort by the Republicans to recall Senator Josh Newman, mm-hmm. okay, who succeeded Bob Hoff's state Senate seat, District 29.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a huge effort.
He was recalled.
And there was a huge effort. So people, the reason why it passed is this, okay? Most people, including Republicans, Democrats, and no party preference, but especially Republicans, they hate tax increases. Mm-hmm. So when the Democrat Central Committee used that message, spreading the fake news that Senator Bob Hoff, while in the legislature, he voted for billions of, $1.6 billion of tax increases.
$16 billion.
Oh, $16 billion, yeah, mm-hmm. yeah. So that's like a big fake news, because it was not true. But people do not have the ability to discern whether the message is false or truth. So when there's a doubt, they want to stay safe and not vote. They did not vote for Bob Hoff. Mm-hmm. So their strategy was successful, because they do not want to face Bob Hoff.
I don't really understand why the strategy work. I dare say, if you come across 10 people and ask them, do you like your gasoline tax be increased by 63 cents per gallon? Mm-hmm. And do you want your registration be charged, overcharged for $175? I would expect 9 out of 10 will say no.
That's why their message was effective, because they accused Bob Huff raised taxes. That's the fake news part.
But you had the overlay of the recall campaign that was all focused on a Democrat that raised taxes. Now they're making the accusation, and nobody knew it was the Democrats doing this. It's DCCC, which doesn't say Democrat anywhere, mm-hmm. and the House Majority PAC. Well, the majority is held by the Republicans, not the Democrats.
No.
So you have what looked like right-wing organizations saying Huff raised taxes too. So you recalled Josh Newman successfully. He's out of office, or will be shortly.
They drag you in.
But they sort of made a recall against my record with fake news. And so it was all tax related. That was their whole message against me.
And also, it sounds like if it is true, of course, it sounds like an illegal issue. To use a fake news as a lie and to lie in the campaign is illegal, isn't it?
Well, you can say, truthfully, you can say anything in a public campaign. But if you're saying something is not true, then I can send a cease and desist letter. All this legal wrangling and stuff positions mm-hmm. you. But the reality is, it's free speech, public arena, and you don't have the same libel type of laws that you have for regular people.
No. That's a different case.
Or slander.
I would have to clarify, right? Mm-hmm. You can take it easy. I, as a media man, I would not take it easy. Mm-hmm. You can say anywhere you go around, say, Jack Chow is not a handsome man. Mm-hmm. Okay, that's your opinion. In your eye, Jack Chow is the most ugliest guy on earth. If you say, I raped a woman last night, though, I'm going to put you in jail. Am I right? Because you're specifically talking about the last night record.
Yeah, but when you know, by the time you started and finished the legal process, The election is long gone.
That's the problem in the public arena. And there are protections for free speech. But if you're saying something as blatant as that, a campaign would have to say something. I supported, I didn't vote for, but I supported people getting the opportunity to vote on a tax themselves. This is Prop A, 1A in 2009, I think it was.
I see.
The people that actually raised the taxes, I mean, we recalled the Senate Republican leader that negotiated that deal. We made him right then.
You were a big part of the Josh Newman recall,
right? Absolutely, because he was night and day compared to me holding the seat, didn't vote for that tax. They were trying to get me to support it, and I was trying to get them to put that on the ballot for the people that he signed. They get Newman, and they raised the tax and didn't put it on the ballot.
And they may correct me if I'm wrong, and you may, Senator, honorable, you're always honorable to me, correct me if I'm wrong. I can say, I always say, at each and every of the election promotion show, I said, promotion is the time to say who I am, what I did, what I can do, what I promise, mm-hmm. right? It is not time to say, I can, you can't. I can, you can't. I'm good, you're bad. No, that's not democracy. Democracy, you have your freedom to say however good you are. Whereas you have no right to say others are bad. Am I right? Am I understanding democracy in the right way?
Well, in the political arena, you can say somebody's bad, and you say why. Now, the thing is, there's also a saying in politics that if you're explaining, you're losing. And that's what your opposition tries to do. They try to paint you a certain way, and then you have to spend your resources to say, no, I'm not. Either that, or you stay focused on your message. Now, my message was, I'm 100% rated by the California Taxpayers Association, 100% rated by the California Chamber of Commerce, A-rated by Howard Jarvis Taxpayers Association. Mm-hmm. I was Senate Republican leader for 4 years. All those things are inconsistent with somebody who's a tax and spender, right? Somebody that raised taxes.
Okay.
But they create doubt. So when you have somebody that just doesn't know, when they go to fill out that thing, raised taxes, they don't know. So they vote something different. 17 people running just changes the whole
thing. Yeah, exactly. Am I wrong, right on trying to understand the whole picture with that some kind of atmosphere where created, an environment created without everybody understanding what exactly it was in the past, absolutely. Right? To back 2009, and then when the momentum was created, the fingers are pointed. So, is that a way the why the strategy worked?
Well, it works because they create doubt. And at the end of the day, some voters are very educated. Most voters are not. Mm. You know, they'll hear the name Bob Huff. I think I remember that. You know, but they're not sure why. Others, you know, and so with the onslaught against me, it was everywhere you turn, you're hearing Bob Huff raise taxes. He'll huff and puff and make your taxes go up, I think was our catchline or something like that. So it's kind of clever, but it brands
me. Speaking of record, though, I even recall those days when we talk about SB5, or SB5, right?
SCA5.
SCA5. I even recall those days, and you were the one in the up front. You were the one of the vanguards fighting against it, right?
So insiders remember that. A lot of people don't remember that. So we have to tell that message. That's part of what campaigning is. We had a very short election cycle, basically 4 or 5 months to run what's normally a year and a half campaign. And so in that short period of time, we're raising money, but the Democrat Party has unlimited sources. So we estimate they spend over $1 million, whereas we're spending half that amount saying the positive message. So, you know, we're not sitting here crying, complaining about it. It's politics.
I see.
It's just that it was a pretty unlevel playing field is the best way to put it.
To my audience, I myself used to be on the left for a lot. And starting about the beginning of Obama's second term, though, I started to see things that I did not want to see. And by, I now call myself middle of the road. I'm independent, I'm whatever. I'm politically freelancing, how about that? Right, so I do say things that I feel, right? I don't want our politics be messed up in a way like that. It is not a cheerleaders at a game. It's not that. It's a politics. You got to say why, something like that. Right? So anyway, today with my two dear friend, Honorable Senator Bob Huff, and his beautiful wife, Mei Mei He, and who is also a political fighter herself. I call her a brave advocate. I thought she might be just laying in bed drinking hot teas. She is as fresh as before.
Oh, thank you.
Good, very good. Okay, let's take a short moment now. When we come back, we will continue to find what we can chew in this past election. So stay with us. Hello, dear friends. Welcome back to the show. Jack Chow on the GNE TV with the East West Show. With lots of pleasure, because I am the one that I got a chance to touch base with every great human being. And I mean touch his mind or her mind, right? Today in Touching Mind, I have my two dearest friends with me. I have Honorable Bob Huff, a former senator and a candidate for the past election. And for the 39th district of congressional seat, and with him, her lovely wife and political advocate herself, a hero in my eye that I respect a lot. So welcome back to you, back to the show.
Thank you.
Okay, now, looking at the past election though, I feel a little better when I look at the governor race. So, because we have one blue, one red there so far. Villaraigosa, somebody call him Tony Villar. Anyway, the same person didn't make it to the second. So now we have blue versus red until at least hang on till November, right? So your comment, please, of that thing?
You know, and the backdrop to that is there was a lot of news right before the election that the Republican Party has dropped to 25% registration now, and no party preference has actually edged them out. But in a primary like this, you do have more Republicans that show out to vote. But the important thing about having a Republican and a Democrat on the ballot in the fall is it will help motivate Republicans to come out to vote because they at least have a champion they can cast a ballot for. And usually it's the top of the ticket that defines the race and who shows up. That's why presidential year, you know, the presidential year, you have a higher turnout. More people are interested in doing that. Sometimes they don't even vote the rest of the ticket, which is a waste of a vote. But in an off presidential cycle, it's a governor cycle like this time, having a Republican on the ballot is super important because we will get a higher turnout in November. And that helps us in all these contested congressional seats and the state Senate seats and the assembly seats and all the way down the line. So it's very important. That was a big win.
And your take on this thing, phenomena?
Well, like Bob says, we do need somebody at the top of the ticket to encourage and motivate people, voters, to come out to vote for the governor and therefore the down tickets. So that is very important for Republicans. So it is a good thing that we do have a Republican candidate in the race. And I believe that a lot of people will come out and consolidate behind him and support him. Our Republican governor candidate.
When that showed up, I feel excited. I said, okay, that's the only thing I feel excited about, because lots of my friends on the right hand side didn't make it. I feel sad about it. Not for friendship, but for California, for God's sake, please. All right, good. When look at this one though, now we have the numbers in between the first place and the red, the second place, between blue and red, though, are still big, about half and half, about twice, right? And yet we have 6 months from now on to make a point. Winning or losing is one thing. Making a point is the other. Do you think we have time, we're using this 6 weeks time, I mean, 6 months time, to make a point, I mean, healthy point?
You're going to see a very big contrast between what the Democrat candidate Gavin Newsom stands for and what Cox, the Republican candidate, stands for.
John Cox, yeah.
Newsom, former mayor of San Francisco, not arguably, the most liberal city in the state, versus Cox, a business guy just trying to, you know, conduct business, make jobs, and provide services, right? So you have a big difference. Newsom never saw a tax he didn't like. Where Cox is standing against and led the fight, actually, against the tax that ended up getting Newman recalled. And they're putting an initiative on the ballot, we believe it'll qualify, that will repeal that tax. So you're going to have John Cox and the anti-tax guys against Gavin Newsom and the pro-tax guys. And we're already the highest tax state in the nation. And whether you're Republican or Democrat, they're tired of that. Some that don't, in the upper income, okay, they may be taxed more, but it doesn't really hurt them. They still live comfortably. But the average hardworking family, I mean, the taxes hit us hard. So that will resonate, and that's when you can get a difference way beyond the registration of a party. You capture an idea that motivates the other side, then you get their votes.
That makes lots of sense. Mm-hmm. And your take, Wimei?
Well, I think if you look at the recall Josh Newman number, I think it was, close to 60% of the people.
67? Yeah, I recall last time I said.
It's just huge.
I may be wrong, don't quote me.
You know, like Bob just said, that the Republican registration in California is only about 25%. But you have over 60% of people voted to recall Josh Newman. They're sending a very clear message that they're tired of all this tax increases. They don't want it. They didn't want it. They don't want it. And I think that's why Democrat was very smart in putting out the fake news saying that Bob raised taxes. So, you know, when people didn't really know, they cast it out, and that's why, you know, we had a result that what we have today. But on the other hand, the voters send a very clear message. They don't want to see any tax increases.
Exactly.
And therefore, there is a huge chance that we can pass the initiative to repeal the gas tax in November. So that's an opportunity.
Yeah, exactly. And I believe that your two statements are exactly the ones that hit the nail on the head, right? And what confuses me, what messed me around, is the fact that we have more than 60% of voters voting to get Josh Newman out. which we call the tax guy. Mm-hmm. All right? Okay, now. And then we have governor first place in blue color, mm-hmm. right? Talking about tax increase and looking around what he has done in San Francisco, right? So on and so forth, right? Now. And yet, what we see as a result, the first place he got, the blue gets the first place. I mean, to represent the Californian constituents who 60%, more than 60%, go against tax increase. So the mathematics doesn't work. Do you see what I mean?
Well, keeping in mind that in the governor's race, you had multiple candidates. In the recall campaign, there was a simple question.
Yes and no.
Should we recall
yes.
Josh Newman
Good.
Yeah. or not?
Mm-hmm.
That's real simple.
Yes.
And then they were painting it, and there were signs all around the district that said, Josh Newman raised taxes.
Mm-hmm.
So Newman equaled taxes equaled, no, we don't want any more
yeah.
of that.
All right.
Recall him.
So,
it's different for the governors where you got uh-huh. a lot of different people.
In other words, it's only word of mouth, right? It's only propaganda. It's only promotion. If you guys do something, do it hard enough, get the message out. In 2009, I didn't raise tax, right? And this one, and for the first place, Josh, Newsom, what he did in the past, so on and so forth. If I believe lots of people are kind of a followers, there are more followers than actually checkers like myself. Right, I check who is who did what. And they say, oh yeah, go that way. Okay, let's go that way, like that kind of thing. So now, if you do enough promotion, do you think you will turn things around with the next 6 months?
Well, it's not just that we do enough promotion. You have to understand Democrats have been able to raise a lot more money, campaign dollars, than Republicans. They have more money than we do. That's one. Number two is most of the media are left-leaning, okay? They are not going to talk to their audience, their readers, you know, the real stories. They always try to twist it somehow, okay, misleading the voters. So, you know, it is, what you say is, yes, it could happen, but it takes a lot of money, and it takes the media to really, you know, but the media is not with Republicans. I mean, every chance they have, pretty much, okay, they paint Republicans
in
a terrible light.
Yeah, she's talking about the huge general media.
Right.
Like you said, you're middle of the road, and you're kind of looking right every now
yeah,
and then.
Yeah, I'm tilting, yeah.
You know, in all fairness, John and Ken, popular radio
yeah,
disc jockeys.
AM 640.
Yeah. They were all for the recall. They were pounding on Josh Newman every day.
Yeah.
But they have a select conservative audience.
They are very yeah. conservative.
But in the
and
general
they are,
selective.
They are the one. They yeah. are the one
but
playing a core mm-hmm. with the recall.
Yeah.
They had over and over again the campaign signature down there in Orange County.
Right.
All right, I was there once, right? So, okay. The things are exactly on the contrary. If you claim that the media, mainstream media, all tilted to the left, so on and so forth, and they are the most right people. I mean, AM 640.
And it used to be talk
John
radio was dominated by right-wing
yeah,
you know, conservatives.
Uh-huh.
Now you get some more that are centrist or left-leaning, but when you get into like cable news and all, you look at MSNBC, CNN, and you know the main networks, they tend to be left-leaning without
and
any
once
question.
Again, I gotta get back mm-hmm. to you. You were talking about in a democratic state, right? Okay, now, if we talk about the politicians, they can be Democratic, they can be Republican, left or right, so on and so forth. To average Joe, average Sue like me, right? They don't know partisanship. They don't have a line of partisanship. Mm-hmm. Whoever takes more money out of my pocket is I am my enemy. That's it. Mm-hmm. That's simple. So make that clear. Make that point clear to every constituents, and you get a victory. You win.
Tax is just one of the issues. Okay, different group have different litmus test. Okay, some people are you know. Focusing on immigration policy, some people have pro-life, you know.
Some education,
mm-hmm. some transportation, you know, everybody's focus is different, okay? So it really depends on how the issues are impacting the voters. That's what they will make their decision. It's not just the tax issue.
Although that's a key one. That's it's usually a winning one, right. issue when you can make
yes.
that.
Mm. But there are so many different factors that people are considering. So it really depends on how well, how much money you have. You have to understand what I just said, okay?
All right, okay.
Democrats have a lot more money than Republicans.
All right, anyway, well, you can make more money.
Dollars.
All right, okay, anyway.
No, you cannot make it. People have to make the donations.
I know, I know, you cannot, I know, yeah.
They don't have the...
You can collect more donations, all right,
yeah,
anyway.
Yeah, but people are not willing to donate,
sure,
and that's the problem.
Yeah, okay. Well, anyway, my dear friends, today in the after talk of the election, I call it an after talk, after shock, after whatsoever, but it's after election discussion, we believe that the subject still needs to be chewed, and that we want to meander on the subject for quite a bit, at least I'm determined to, I will do so, because it's the education we're talking about. We are educating ourselves, we are doing that. All right, with me are my two dearest friends. I have Honorable Bob Hoff, former senator, and I have her beautiful wife, May May, my dear friend too. And we're sharing the thoughts with the audiences about what had happened in California. Stay with us. We'll dig more. We'll be back. Hello, dear friends, lovely audiences. Welcome back to the discussion. It's a wonderful discussion, especially when it happens after election. Well, before election, I did a lot. For the after election, this is the second I'm talking about election. Election, that's the beauty of democracy. That's why I came here for 36 years ago, right? I never missed a single chance of voting. And it was on a rainy day. It was one time on a rainy day, I I didn't get an umbrella, and I still, fulfilled the task, right? Why? Because this is what I came here for. And lots of problem is that people forget that. People forget that, what they came here for. Okay, now you look at check Beijing, check U.S. Embassy. You tell me how long the queue is, zigzagging about miles around the house. They all want to get here, right? Once they get here, they forget. Ah, sky is blue, water is clean, so on and so forth. Okay, let's enjoy. They forget. Somebody has paid for it. Our sky shouldn't be this blue if there's nobody before him or her did the fight. What kind of fight? Not a physical fight. We're talking about political fight. In terms of election, we are talking about the political fight. And with me, my friend, Honorable Bob Hoff, is sharing his thought, and his beautiful wife, May May, is doing the same thing. We want to make a point. The point is that somebody may be right, somebody may not be always right. So let this somebody be challenged by this somebody, and this somebody probably get him power. And when this somebody gets him power, this somebody might not be always right, and then you have a contender always, right? So that's the system. For a state, especially a state like California, to be run by a single party, I don't know, I don't care who, it's not healthy. Do you think so?
Absolutely. When you have single party rule, you really have a dictatorship, and you don't get opposing thoughts. And even when we got into a super minority position right before I became leader, we found that we as the minority party, the Republicans, were shut up even more. So they didn't even talk to us about the budget. They put out their budget. They do everything they want to do. They kill the bills they want to in committee. And so it makes it very difficult in that marketplace of ideas to get any balance. So when Democrats will tell you the only way, if you want to fix your roads, well, you got to raise taxes. And we say, but we don't get any, press on that. We have surpluses every year. You know, take that, do what you're supposed to with it, fix the roads. People are already paying taxes.
Yes, yes,
why do you
yes,
have to go out and get a special tax when they're already paying taxes and you have an abundant amount of them? So it's just those kind of arguments are lost, and it becomes, you get taken hostage and you believe that, oh, what they're telling me is the only reality. You know, there is no alternate thought. That's why it's so important to have two parties, because they present different choices. They present different ideas.
Exactly. Your take, May May, please.
Same thing. One party dominance is it's not good for
regardless
the people.
Regardless who, right?
Yeah.
Regardless
it's not
who.
Good for the, mm-hmm. for the people because, you know, there's just no real democracy.
Mm-hmm. You know what I do? On my show, I have 5 days from Monday to Friday. I do five shows, right? And I purposely keep one extreme left as my guest quite often here. Mm-hmm. And I purposely do the same thing to keep a guy of the extreme right. Mm-hmm. Why do I do so? Because I want to keep myself balanced.
And the other three days, you'll find people who are in the middle.
And the other 3 days, exactly.
And which
the
one
other
are we?
The other three, sure. The other 3 days, whoever, right? Whoever. So me running my show in such a way, I would say somebody running California better copy my model, right? I would say that works, that's safe. Okay, the thing is that, I give you an example. You just mentioned a very important thing, a core issue. The core issue being that we have lots of job needs to be done. Our infrastructure, our water, our so on and so forth. And for infrastructure, for water, you tell me how many times we've been taxed. How many measures, the propositions we have. We got to hear lots of that. And the recent years I could recall, as long as I could recall, we got three times. With the measure for the money. Where is the money? And we're still raising tax? Okay, now, suppose we want to raise tax to do those though. The third place of Lieutenant Governor Cole Harris, mm-hmm. I interviewed him. And he says, in my hand, California has $189 billion as total revenue. In my hand, I can increase it to $300 billion without raising a penny of tax. I asked him how you do it. Says why? You know what? Our businesses are running away from California because we are taxed them out. Mm-hmm. We're regulated them out. I'll ask them to slow down on suppressing so they'll remain. The money will come along. That's the thing. So now, money needs, between money and the tax, tax is not the only answer. Do you think so?
For the government and the
Democrats? For the government, yes.
No, tax is the only issue because government.
No, the answer to get money.
I'm sorry?
The answer to get money.
How do they get money?
How do you get money? By increased tax or by being business friendly to get lots of people, people doing business.
But in California, it's not possible because it's single party dominance because they pass a law.
Yeah, that's what we're
Lieutenant
talking
Governor
about.
Governor does not have the right to pass any law.
No.
Law is passed.
That's exactly what we're talking about. We're just hitting the core.
Right.
The core is that we're talking about. We're starting the show. We say single party is not safe.
Exactly. So there is no chance now.
That's one of the things that frustrated me. I served as vice chair of budget for a few years.
Mm-hmm.
And the government doesn't have a good model or a metric for saying if I cut these taxes, I'll actually get more revenue because mm-hmm. the businesses will be more productive or you'll draw more businesses into the state.
Mm-hmm.
So they look at it in very simplistic terms. If you raise taxes, you get more money. If you cut taxes, you get less money. The reality is not there. It's somewhere in between because we know if I encourage you to be more productive, you're going to be more productive by doing more business, you're creating more taxes, right? Not at a higher rate.
You're right.
And that's what the Trump tax cut was premised on.
I give you an example. My friend Kurt Hagman, you know Kurt Hagman,
yes.
right?
Uh-huh.
But you're your friend too.
Uh-huh.
Back many years when he was mayor of Chino Hills, they had a problem because their vacant land, they grow grass, and summertime, whatever, the fire seasons, they have always to have to cut it, to trim it, or otherwise a fire hazard.
You got some goats or sheep or something on there.
For that, the city has to pay not a small amount, a small amount, like $50,000 at least for per season for the trimming, like that. When Kurt Hagman took place, he cut the budget off, say, no, we don't need to do that. And he called the farmers, the shepherds, with sheeps and cows to come over. They come in batch in turn to eat the grass. And they pay the city for allowing them to eat the grass. So instead of $50,000 of money paid out, mm-hmm. and also work camp, somebody cut fingers, right? Somebody got a hole in the head, so forth, right? And the city ends up gaining money. So?
Well, let me answer that question. It's very simple. Okay, there's only five council members. In Chino Hills, they're dominated by Republicans. Yeah, so they can pass the law to do it that way, but it's not possible at the state level under one party dominance.
So what do we do?
Well, let me answer.
Elect more Republicans. Right. That's really the only answer.
Let me answer part of that also. If you had a city that had five Democrats on the council, they likely wouldn't be going out and hiring sheep because sheep don't pay union dues. When they have more government employees, more government employees, that gives more money for their unions.
Yeah,
and their unions support them and get them elected.
Union dues.
I mean, totally why our state budget is so bloated. We have so many different union members. They have become the most powerful lobbying force.
Jokingly and sadly, it is a fact. I would say, using Kurt Hagman's example, forget the partisanship. Everybody could forget partisanship, and that could exactly be the way that we turn California around.
Not possible at the state level, because at state level is partisan politics. Well, it's not like local level or the county level is nonpartisan. At the state and at federal, it is very partisan, okay? And big money will come in to change the races, just like in Bob's race.
Things can change. If you and I and Bob, everything, keep on advocating, people may learn.
We've been advocating 30 years.
Well, this is a marathon, it's not a sprint.
30 years.
If you look at Texas, at one time it was Democrat controlled, now it's Republican. You look at Florida, at one time it was Democrat controlled, now it's Republican, but it's still a swing state. It can change, but people have to be so frustrated, and there have to be shows like yours that are out there shining a light to show that, you know, getting a balanced input actually gets you a balanced output.
Mm-hmm.
An imbalanced input, you're not going to like the results.
Let me add something here. Can I add something here?
Yeah, go ahead.
Well, you know, we don't have the final results of Bob's race, right? But what we know so far is, for Chinese, there are about, less than 5,000 return, right, who voted. Only about 1,200 were Republicans. So we've been advocating for the longest time, but we don't see, you know, Republicans and Chinese come out
to
vote.
We'll talk about that when we come back next segment. On this one, we focus, what hands up here, right? And last night I was at dinner, I mentioned to a bunch of friends of mine who are smart guys, everybody is smarter than I am. I said, what if we make a law to get 40 and 40 Democrat and Republican members on the assembly, and 20 and 20 left and right on the Senate House? How about that, Kim? Is that a politically or practically workable? To make a rule, so we
and
have...
And who's making the rule? We got more Democrats there. So no,
well,
they would not pass it.
Well, if it was balanced, would you get more balanced rules?
Yeah, the answer is yes.
But you got to get them
course,
elected.
Yes, of course. And then people will forget partisanship, because partisanship is exactly 2020, a 40-40, right? So does it make sense? Does it make them work to actually deactivate the partisanship? All right, now. You were saying that there are more assembly members or senators on the left-hand side. Okay, I take it okay. What if we motivate the constituents, the voters, to vote that way? Hey, we need a law, let's go 40-40, 2020.
You have to qualify as an initiative, and that will require us going out to get signatures.
Let's go get a signature campaign. Signature campaign to make laws like that. If I'm not doing this show, I'll do it. I'll do the signature campaign.
It's very costly. And then,
I know. I'm not rich, but I have friends. You know, I can ask
in
around.
In California, it is, how do I say this? Okay, it is election by district, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So because Republican registration is only 25%,
I'll go district by district just to tell people I'm in no partisanship. I'm in no partisan. I'm whoever. I'm in the middle, right? The road. I call for 40-40, 20-20.
There are interest groups out there.
Well, if you're in an area that happens to be 70% Democrat, why would they want to have half-half? They're giving up some of their political capital.
Yes.
And they're not going to do that.
Well.
Okay. Nice shot, though.
Yeah, I get that shot, right? From the head.
Not going to stick.
Okay, anyway, my dear friend, I'm joking along, because the best way to handle problems is to joke. So, with me today, I'm so happy with my dear friend, Honorable Bob Hove, former senator. And during his time, California really had some, kind of like we have a good hope had. And with him is his beautiful wife, Mei Mei He, who is a hero in my eye, and she is a fighter herself. Let's take a short moment now. When we come back, I want to put things together. I want to take one challenge to our own folks about voting. All right, shall we, please? Hello, dear friends, lovely audience. This is my dear fellow Angelinos, Californians, fellow Americans. And welcome back to the discussion. As a matter of fact, I'm not talking about California only, it's talking about U.S. politics. Once in the country with democracy, you really want to look like once in Rome, do Romans do, right? Once in the country with democracy, do things in a democratic way. So this is simple, such a simple regulation, simple rules, whatever. I feel very sad in reviewing the numbers of voting, the rate, voting rate of the past election. And I feel sad about it. And your comment on this issue, please, about the voting rate?
Well, we're not going to know completely until about a month afterwards. It takes a while. Like, there's thousands of ballots still, even in the congressional district I ran in, that have to be counted. They're turned in on election day, or there's a question, they fill out a provisional ballot. So that takes about a month, and then the registrars have to certify the election within 30 days. Mm-hmm. At that point, we start getting the detail of the precincts, who was it that actually voted. We get a sense of where the ethnicity is. Mm-hmm. And historically, we have been underrepresented at the polls by Chinese or Asians in particular, because they'll talk, they'll complain, but they don't vote. And they won't be taken
exactly
seriously
the
until
point.
They vote.
Yeah, that's exactly the problem. May your take?
Same thing, I have been advising our Chinese and Asian friends that they have to be part of this political system, okay? Because this is a country based on laws and regulations. If we do not participate in the political system, get our voice heard, we'll have no voice, okay? No one will take us seriously. Mm. To express ourselves, people will go on the street, they'll do protesting, they will, create maybe a momentum for that one moment, but there is no continuity. So when we do not get out to vote and get our voice heard, nobody will take us seriously, okay? So almost in every election, Asians have historically, compared to other ethnicities or compared to the mainstream, our voting rate has always been historically low. So that's why, people may not take us seriously, because over a period of time, when we the Chinese, for instance, we only come out to vote for someone else who has an Asian or a Chinese face. Mm. They don't care about how much, for instance, Bob has done to protect our Asian and Chinese community. When there's a choice that's a Chinese choice, they don't care. They will, in this election, we can see that as well. They will vote for a Chinese face who has never been in the political arena and who has never demonstrated what he has done to help the Chinese, to protect the Chinese rights. So, it is a sad situation. It's not going to help us. We will only continue to marginalize ourselves in the mainstream politics.
Don't feel bad, Bob, because you don't have a Chinese face. I like you. I like you, exactly the same way I like my brother, who has a Chinese face, mm-hmm. right? But the thing is that Mei Mei has pointed out a very mm-hmm. serious issue. The serious point, though, people, I'm not criticizing my folks, okay? I'm just saying that if you happen to be hit, I'm very sorry, because I do not mean to hurt you. I just want to make a point clear. They either don't care who's who. I don't care, all right? I wake up and I drive to work and I come back home, hug a wife, and then, well, they, that's a day. Another day, start the same thing, same way. Who be the governor, who be the senator, who be whoever, oh, come on. Yeah, that's their business. This is number one. Number two group of people, when they do care, they care about faces. Mm-hmm. All right. In between Bob and Mei Mei, I would probably cast my vote to Mei Mei.
I would too.
For two reasons. Number one, she's Asian. Number two, mm-hmm. she's beautiful.
Thank you.
Well, nobody doesn't like a beautiful woman, right? Right. So you're ugly, you're a man, come on.
You smell
the same way I do, forget it, like that. And then this is a this preference kills the only chance of doing things right, mm-hmm. right? When I say lots of people die halfway to get to the United States, right? They get killed. Those guys that come in the container, right? And a few months ago in San Diego, mm-hmm. there's a bunch died in ship containers, right? Okay, they pay life to get to this beautiful flag of democracy, and once mm-hmm. here, I don't care. Are you talking about you treat yourself right? So that's the point, right? So now, and the election is over, but there's another one, right? Right now we're talking about November, right? We really got to encourage our folks. Okay, forget the face, right? Number one, walk out, right? Walk out the door, go to exercise your right with democracy to actually vote, right? And back a little bit, just now, we're talking about 40-40-20-20, right? If we say, if all the people dare to vote, and by the way, the registrar messed up 20,000 votes, or headcount.
Like 120,000.
Yeah,
120,000, yeah. Right? 120,000 headcount, and that would be probably affected the result, right?
It could. Certainly, there's people that showed up to vote, their name wasn't there, so they just go home. Smart people or educated know they can fill out a provisional ballot and then let mm-hmm. the elections folks sort it out later on.
Mm-hmm. Well, okay. The county, LA County, sent out a press release on June 5th.
And Election day.
And gave instruction to all the polling places. People who walked in with, you know, when their name is not on the roster, they will still be able to vote. You know, you don't know whether they really are, you know, registered voters or not. You know, they would just be given a provisional
ballot. That's a patch-up.
It's a patch-up, but also, you know, it can lead to voter fraud. Because you don't know who is the person walked
exactly,
in. You know,
exactly.
They just say, you know, I want a ballot.
Especially mm-hmm. with the county positions. More related to the county positions. Mm-hmm. Do you think so? Okay. Anyway, back to the subject. Mm-hmm. Back to the subject. My whole point was that if everybody walk out to vote, and then we take it as a fact. Well, this is how people voted. There's no other excuses, right? So, well, you know, things will get better, that much, much better that way. So, mm-hmm.
yeah. Well, you know.
She's smiling. I'm naive, I know.
Well, you know, see, in the U.S. is a democratic system, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is that democracy?
Not to be confused.
Okay. I know.
With Democrats.
I know. That's why a lot of people don't understand.
Yeah,
you know,
sure.
Thinking that Democratic
you're
Party is
the word. You're borrowing the word.
Yeah, you know. Yeah, right. But you know, we understand that. For instance, in Australia, right, mm-hmm. the voting is mandatory. If you don't vote, there is some kind of fine. Okay, so people will have to vote. So, but is it really better for everybody to get out to vote? Because right now, we don't really have a system to verify people coming to vote, they are really eligible, you know, or they are really registered voters,
you know. It doesn't make a lot of sense.
So, you know, that we just like securing the border.
You're 18 years old. You have to register for service. Am I right? Okay, for military service. Make it mandatory. And then you're a citizen, you are registered to vote. So make it mandatory. That makes a lot of sense.
I just don't think that law will pass.
Encourage Chinese in particular to educate yourself on the issues, learn about who's running, and vote.
Exactly.
You know, we don't have a system here like Australia where we force you to or fine you not to, but you're giving up such a great part of what made this nation great, which was the ability to choose those that make the laws and regulate things. And when we don't agree, we can go recall them as we did Josh Newman. But stay engaged. Then we will, when Chinese take their voting rights seriously, then they will be respected.
Talking about recall though, what really functions in the whole thing, it is voting. Mm-hmm. Right? It is voting. There's lots of people spoke out.
They were motivated to come out.
And and as a result, we see more than 60% say, yes, go recall him.
Right.
Like that.
Strong message.
When that can be done, the message itself is strong that everything can be done. Right? If you advocate it, if you promote it, if we make it known. He mentioned about knowledge. He mentioned about education. We need to be politically educated. Lots of people, lots of folks need to. Once again, don't feel bad, my dear folks. I just want to be one of you. I am one of you, right? We all need to be educated. How the whole system, how it works. Maybe knows a lot more than I do. I know a little bit, but you know, we feel bad already of not knowing enough. And then when you say you refuse to be educated in this area, though, that's not good. That's not a right take, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, okay, now overall, we're looking down to November, right? In November, what do you predict things will happen?
Well,
I always give it a hard one to you.
I will, yeah, it's a hard one because whoever holds the White House, the opposite party generally picks up congressional seats. Generally, but not always. After 9/11, when George Bush was president, we actually picked up seats. Republicans picked up seats because the nation came together over a common tragedy. Mm-hmm. So this year, statistically, you should see some seats go to the Democrat Party. Will it be enough to change the outcome in Congress? I think they're overplaying their hand here in California, and so I'm going to predict today that they're not going to be able to do that. We didn't see this red to blue wave that they were expecting to come crashing onto California. We do have Democrat and Republican in virtually all these congressional districts. Having Cox at the top of the ballot is going to help Republican turnout. Having a gas tax repeal on the ballot is going to help drive Republican turnout, not just Republican, but also folks of any registration that just don't like taxes. And when those people show up, they tend to elect people that don't like taxes as well. So I think it's a good year for us, that as long as the people are engaged, we will have a good outcome. I'm not always happy with the outcome, but I am happy when people take the time to educate themselves and vote their conscience. And maybe I'm in the minority. I have been before. Certainly served that way up in Sacramento. But as long as people are exercising their right and casting the ballot, I can suck it up and move on to the next election and try to argue my point a little stronger.
Okay, very good. To be more specific, Bob, for California governor race in between the red and the blue, what will happen?
You know, conventional wisdom would say Gavin Newsom will win because it's a Democrat state. But again, you have Cox on an issue that I think is going to resonate. So we'll see. How will he raise the money necessary? Gavin's got all the Bay Area money, and that's where most of the Democrat money comes from in California. Incidentally, Bay Area dominates politics. When you think about Nancy Pelosi or even Feinstein, they both come out of the Bay Area.
Where's Cox based out?
San Diego. And you know, San Diego is a left-leaning city now. It used to be more conservative, but that's where Pete Wilson came out of as a Republican senator and then a governor as well. So there's still a conservative base down there.
What will be those issues to make a point, each of them, during for the 6 months?
Well,
in other words, which are the issues they're going to be hold on to.
Well, you're going to see the Republicans under Cox are going to talk about the high rate of taxes, how it's driving businesses out of the state, which mm-hmm. it's certainly doing, mm-hmm. and ratcheting back to a more affordable state where our kids can actually afford to live here, because nobody likes to see their kids moving to Texas or to Illinois or wherever they're going, you know, mm-hmm. but they're not staying here. So you're going to have that sort of common sense, we've reached too far, bring it back a little bit, against Gavin Newsom, who represents the party that actually got us on the edge of the cliff about to fall off. Mm-hmm. So I think it's going to be a very stark contrast. What's playing against us is Newsom is very charismatic. As you pointed before, people vote for attractive people. He's an attractive person.
Yeah, yeah.
But his policies are absolutely killing us, and they're killing the state.
Not as much, yeah. Very good. Okay, we're over time, but I'm ready to listen to Bob and to May May, and I believe this is not the only one. We need to still come back because we were talking about education, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, please, let's do it. Let's do it. You do yours, I do mine. We all pay our dues. How about that?
Good.
To cultivate a culture that we love this country. We came here for, you were born here for, whatever. And we want to really, really to make sure that we love it in the right way. So my dear friends, my lovely audiences, thank you for watching this show. And for my guests, thank you for sharing, especially on the third day after election.
Great to be with you.
Thank you very much, Jack. Thank you.